Calcium, vitamin D, they do work together. They have this really great relationship. They work together to form and maintain strong bones, improve your bone health. It can decrease fractures or your risk of fractures. And vitamin D is crucial for calcium absorption, which is why it's added to milk. It's a government mandate. It's not naturally occurring in there. It's added. So calcium, it's important to really obtain from diet and or supplements. Our bodies cannot produce calcium. You need it from an outside source. Calcium, if your intake is inadequate, it will, you know, your bones will leach it. So it will drop it into the bloodstream to make sure that that level stays normal. It is, again, best from food sources. Your blood level does not affect your needs. So I think I hear this all the time in terms of, oh, my blood level of vitamin D was this, and I'm taking this much, but my calcium is normal, and your calcium always should be normal. And if it's not, again, then your body will look to make sure it's normal and release some storage from bone. So calcium recommendations really are very general for less than 50 years of age. I have excluded any pre or postpartum, breastfeeding, any of that stuff, because the needs are definitely different. This is just for average females under the age of 50 or 50 without a fracture. You have a little bit of window after you give birth, after you have a fracture, to remineralize bone. And so your needs, your calcium needs, do jump a little after that. So reading food labels, just to reiterate, it is based on 1,000 milligrams, the food label. You will always see calcium on a food label, no matter the food packaging, because it is government mandated. Vitamin D will also be on there. So vitamin D is based on 400 IUs, which is the really low end of the recommended needs for any age. So if this happens to be a cup of skim milk, which is 80 calories, it has 9 grams of protein, which is actually a little higher. 30% of calcium, which equals 300 milligrams, and it has 25% of a daily amount of vitamin D, which equals 100 IUs. So again, dairy foods, I sort of just rank them in greatest amount of calcium to least. Just this is, again, the dairy foods. So the kefir, there are certain brands that they can manipulate a little, and if you ultra pasteurize something, you can actually get a little bit more calcium out of it. So I won't say the brand, but there are certain skim milks that are a little bit thicker and more palatable and not like kind of an atypical skim milk. So that has a little bit more calcium in it. But kefir, if people like it, I know one of the former doctors that was here sort of told every patient of hers to have kefir, and every patient was having so much dairy. And kefir, if you like it, I mean, I think any of the stuff, if you can get the stuff from food is medicine, it definitely helps, and it saves you money on having to buy supplements. So again, if you go down the list here, the one thing I do want to just kind of point out as I go through all these dairy foods is, prior in my discussion about kind of overall good diet quality, your whole diet shouldn't be dairy. You shouldn't have 75% of your diet being dairy, because there's no variation there. So there again, I just listed in basic, you know, format, the calcium fortified foods. I would say about 5 years ago, maybe even a little bit more, I noticed the marketing trend was more calcium fortified or good source of calcium. And so it's just added years ago. I mean, I would say for 15, 20 years, there's a sugar-free hot chocolate mix that has always had 300 milligrams of calcium in it. It's like a little bit of a supplement. So if you were going to have that, great, you're getting a little bit of calcium from it, but definitely not necessarily a reason to just start drinking that as well. Non-dairy foods, so almonds, these are sort of in least to most. So if you also look down, so in the non-dairy foods, almond is a non-dairy food. It does naturally have a smidge of calcium in it, but if you look at how much calcium is in here, so 1 ounce of almonds, which is really a recommended serving, there's only 70 milligrams of calcium. So in order to get a really good amount of calcium, you would have to have like a cup of almonds, which is really a little bit more than our recommended estimated intake at one time. And also it's just more calories. So you just have to be cognizant of calories if you're trying to up your dietary calcium. Broccoli as well, kale, the dark green leaf, these are really a good source. You know, I've had a lot of people over the years doing kale, you know, or the green juices and liquefying a bunch of stuff. But if you noticed, 8 ounces of kale, which is a cup, has 90 milligrams. So you really have to have a lot of kale. And so if you're having that much kale in a day to get a good amount of calcium in your diet, your GI tract might be a little bit not so happy, and it's just, it makes things sometimes a little bit tough. So sardines, they have to have with bones. Same thing with salmon, any of those fish. If you're having bones, that bones are where the calcium is, and so then therefore you have to make sure you're getting that type of fish with bones. Soybeans, edamame, same thing. It does have a little bit of natural calcium in there, but if you are having a cup of soybeans, which I'm not sure many people do on a regular basis because everyone wants to have soy sparingly, and so 175 milligrams isn't a cup of soybeans, but again, you just have to be careful with volume. And then non-dairy milks and yogurts, it really varies. Now so many of these, there's so many milks. So there's oat milk, you know, cashew, walnut, soy, rice, almond, and they are really just fortified. It's like taking a liquid supplement in a way. So your calcium equivalents, these I just sort of put here to kind of make it a little easier. Each one of these equals about 300 milligrams of calcium, which would be the equivalent of 1 8-ounce cup of milk. So when I say also the milk, it doesn't matter if you're having a dairy milk, skim, 1%, 2% whole milk, they all have the same amount of calcium, vitamin D, protein. They just vary in fat and therefore calories. So vitamin D, why is it important? Where are you going to get it? And what are the recommendations? So vitamin D, again, it's, you know, the major role is to really help maintain normal blood levels of calcium and phosphorus. Promotes calcium absorption in the gut, in your intestines, and it helps promote brain and muscle health and immune function and the reduction of inflammation. It's really helpful in so many ways. Fat soluble vitamin, so your body, again, it does really store the excess, and I think that so many people generally, especially a lot of general practitioners or internists are recommending, you know, just you may as well take 1,000. I just saw a patient recently who came in who was speaking a ridiculous amount every day because she's like, oh, I have osteoporosis, and her blood level is 85, which is not above normal, but definitely at the higher end. And again, it's not helping her. She still is fracturing. She still, you know, keeps fracturing this one hip. So it's, you just have to really be careful because it is really naturally occurring in very few foods. Your blood level that's going to be tested is this. And your blood levels, again, less than 30 is kind of, you know, it's really associated with deficiency. 30 is sort of, we consider the low end of normal, really specifically for bone health. If you already know you have brittle bones, are at risk of brittle bones, have had a fracture, or your status post a fracture, then you really should make sure that your blood level, the goal should be about 50. Research is really showing us that people in blood levels of about in the 40s is really optimal, and it always makes me chuckle because I think, yeah, it's closest to 50, so. The vitamin D recommendations, again, are very generalized, and 400 to 800 international units a day is recommended. An upper limit of about 4,000 a day would be recommended unless you know that you are deficient and therefore you might be told to really do a high-dose supplement. There are some prescriptions that are about 35,000 to 50,000 units a week, but really you can do an over-the-counter. The over-the-counters come in at 4,000. 1,000, 2,000, and a 5,000. So because it's fat soluble, sometimes people play with the numbers and say, oh, if I forget to take it one day, you can take, you know, two the next day. Or if you take a 5,000 unit a week, you know, 5,000 pill, then you could just take it a few times a week. So vitamin D sources, there are very few of them. These are your food sources, eggs. So since it's a fat soluble vitamin, vitamin D, it is really present in the egg yolk. So for all of you who are using just egg whites, you're out of luck. Fatty fish, mackerel, salmon, sardines, tuna. Again, you might have salmon. A lot of people are, you know, oh yes, I'm really healthy and I eat salmon, you know, twice a week, but twice a week isn't necessarily every day. And so you do want some variation, but you know, I don't know a ton of people that are eating mackerel regularly or sardines, to be honest. Fortified foods, again, your milk, your juice, your cereals, all of those other things. The vitamin D content, this is sort of listed from greatest to least. The cod liver oil, if any of you out there actually do this, I still have a handful of patients that do a tablespoon of cod liver oil. Different cultures do it for different reasons. Some do it for shiny hair and nails. Some people do it for digestion. Some people don't really know why they do it. It's just that all their relatives did. And so you can see sort of as you go down the list, there definitely foods that you probably are consuming on a regular basis. Orange juice is definitely on here. I'm never a proponent of drinking juice, but if people do drink juice, and if you have one that's fortified with calcium, at least you're getting, you know, a little bit of calcium, and then you're getting some vitamin D as well. So it has always been called the sunshine vitamin, and I think probably at least on a weekly basis, if not more, I hear someone say, oh, I'm going to go out and get a little vitamin D. And so it always makes me laugh because especially now we're coming out of winter time, and so nobody really, we live in the Northeast, and depending on where you live, if there's a lot of cloud coverage, the pollution, you're really not necessarily getting true UVB rays. The other thing too is if you're using any sort of SPF, whether it's clothing or lotion, spray, whatever it is, it really is filtering out 93 to 98% of those UVB rays, which is what it's supposed to do, but it just doesn't allow you to synthesize for your skin to make vitamin D with sun exposure. So excessive vitamin D, it is, again, it's a fat-soluble vitamin and the excess is stored. Toxicity is rare, but you really want to make sure that you're not getting mega doses of supplementation, you know, via the sun and diet, and just really just, I listed here symptoms just in the event that anyone is currently taking supplementation. A lot of these could be related, these symptoms could be related to honestly anything, but just good information to know. There's always a consequence. We are Americans and we think more is better, but it is not true.